Dear colleagues, I think that we can start this virtual event, this meeting. My name is Timur Mahmutov. I'm a director for international and regional cooperation at the Accounts Chamber of the Russian Federation, and will be moderating this event. So it's our great pleasure to welcome all of you to our final online meeting of SCEI Expert Group on COVID-19 before we present some results on our meetings to the meeting of the governing board. And we have counted, so today, 120 days passed since our first meeting in June this year. So the time runs, so it's very fast that time is going. And today's meeting is finalizing a series of webinars, which focused on knowledge sharing, support during challenging times, but not only. Our aim is to develop recommendations for INTOSAI governing board, and we strive to create a document that would generalize the experience of our community during the pandemic from various perspectives and help us define areas for further developments and improvements. This would finally provide a clear guidance, we believe, on how can keep our organizations successful, operational under challenging conditions, and that would make us more resilient to possible emergency situation in the future. So far, we have already developed a draft of outlines of the documents. We have shared this document, this draft, with members of SCEI group for review. And let me thank our group members for providing their detailed and substantial comments and feedbacks. Based on collective expert opinion, we are now drafting the document itself. The findings and results of all four webinars held since June will serve as a basis for recommendations. So today's webinar is the last piece of this kind of puzzle. It is dedicated to the topic INTOSAI online transition. How can organizations adapt to the new normal of teleworking? Representatives of the INTOSAI General Secretariat, PSC, CBC, KHC, and PFAC will share their experience on the process of transition of their work into the online mode. Here are some questions that we want to raise during this meeting. What steps had to take to continue networking within INTOSAI under challenging conditions? How events INTOSAI were arranged? What tools and platforms were used? What instructions were followed? And what are the main lessons learned? And how do they see the operation of INTOSAI in the future? In addition, representatives from individual SCEIs, such as Italy, Czech Republic, and Pakistan, will share their stories about keeping head above the water and will give their evaluation and point of view on communication with INTOSAI and its operation during the pandemic. I encourage all the participants to use the chat in the right part of your screen to send your questions and remarks to the presentations, and simply use it for sharing your stories as well. Speakers will answer your question during the Q&A session at the end of the webinar. If there is no time to cover all the questions, we'll follow up on them after the webinar, as we did before, in our traditional summary. The discussion will also include a couple of questions from my side. And so please make sure you submit your answers when it is required. So now I have the pleasure to introduce our first speaker, very well known to all of you, Ms. Monica Gonzalez-Kloss, Director of the INTOSAI General Secretariat, Head of International Department, Austria Board of Audit. She will give us an overview on continuity during the crisis from the perspective on INTOSAI General Secretariat. Monica, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Timur, And dear colleagues, it's a special pleasure to address you today. And I have to apologize for whatever reason I can't put on my camera, so it will only be the tone. I'm really sorry for this. So let me start. And first thing, I really hope you are all really well and healthy. Next slide, please. Since the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic and the social distancing, severe travel limitations and profound changes in our lives, the INTOSAI General Secretariat and other INTOSAI bodies have been and continue to be dedicated to assist INTOSAI members find a new way to collaborate and share information to keep the international audit community connected, or in other words, to adapt to the new normal. A number of SCEIs have been facing serious problems due to the lack of digital infrastructure or budget restrictions imposed by their governments. The General Secretariat is aware of the need to support these SCEIs in order to enable them to fulfill their mandates and participate in the activities of INTOSAI. This has been proved by the fact that the INTOSAI initiative to support financially those SCEIs facing severe IT problems in their remote work has raised an enormous interest only in a very few days. The General Secretariat has aimed to provide a clear guidance, next slide please, on how we can keep our organization successful and operational during the coronavirus time, which has really an impact on all of us and also on INTOSAI as a worldwide organization. In this endeavor, INTOSAI is in the excellent company of other international organizations such as the UN, the IMF, the World Health Organization or OECD, which are all striving to assist their members and the global community to keep operational and effective according to the motto, leaving no one behind. In this context, also the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres has confirmed that the pandemic presents a risk to key dimensions of national institutions, including the SCEIs, highlighted in SDG 16 in terms of limiting transparency and access to information, eroding safeguards to accountability, including integrity violations, fraud and corruption, and restricting participation and engagement. These institutional dimensions are critical to provide a resilient response to the crisis. In many countries, government and accountability institutions and civil society are innovating themselves to mitigate possible institutional disruptions. Along this line, INTOSAI and the SCEIs must remain attentive to the environment and cannot remain on the sidelines of the reality where they carry out their work. It is therefore essential that SCEIs monitor the measures in the short, medium, and long term in order to identify the shortcomings and lessons learned that can be useful in future similar disaster situations. For that reason, our member SCEIs need in this difficult situation the assistance and advice from INTOSAI. We have to guarantee that INTOSAI stays fully operational and prepared to face the new challenges, such as complete lockdowns, as we experience with 100% teleworking. Please allow me also to mention in this context the following important paragraph of the Moscow Declaration, which became even more meaningful in the light of the current developments. It reads, SCEIs can foster an experimental mindset to enhance innovation and development. So, if we don't have tools to achieve our objectives, why not create them? In this disaster situation, INTOSAI had to be innovative and open for new developments. And I'm really happy to inform you that reality has shown that INTOSAI has already adapted to these new virtual circumstances very, very well. Next slide, please. Until today, around 40 INTOSAI meetings have taken place virtually. In the last pandemic month, even more meetings have taken place, and these events could definitely count with more participants than ever before. For example, we had the steering committee meetings of the goals, the donor corporation, the PFAC, and in all those, we had lively debates among the participants. In addition, we experienced also 6 working groups, 3 subcommittees, 4 task force strategic planning, 4 independent ambassadors, 3 PFAC COVID-19, 4 SCEI expert group, and 1 SDG coordination meeting, and also 3 very lively CBC panel discussions, 2 IDI boards, and a series of FIP meetings, all this virtually and very successful. We also had a big conference with about more than 200 participants, the EUROSAI OLASEFS conference. And this gave a place for very topical theme discussions, clearly demonstrating that SCEIs continue to develop their expertise and mutual interest in knowledge sharing. And last but not least, the 2020 Governing Board will also be held virtually with full interpretation into all English languages next month. Next slide, please. In these challenging times, regular communication between INTOSAI bodies and its members is more important than ever before. Therefore, we as General Secretariat regularly informed the INTOSAI community about latest developments through the website. We contributed to the PFA COVID-19 initiative, and we most certainly also existed and participated in the SCEI COVID-19 expert group. One of INTOSAI's general tasks, not only during the crisis, but also in the longer term, is to guarantee a quick exchange of experiences and knowledge between INTOSAI bodies and members virtually. The corona crisis will also have a long-term impact on INTOSAI's way to act and methods. Next slide, please. The experience of the last months has shown that virtual meetings include some challenges, like technical problems with regard to different video conference systems, limitations in time due to the great number of different time zones within the INTOSAI community. There's a difference sometimes of about 18 hours, which doesn't make it very easy. Lack of possibilities for additional and explanatory discussions in the so-called couloir encounters. Lack of personal contacts, which are usually very fruitful for our work. But there are, without any doubt, also some few benefits. We have more inclusive participation, as I already mentioned. It's cost-effective and time-saving, environmentally friendly, because this communication, due to the reduced traveling, can contribute to stop the rapid climate change. And there are more possibilities to participate for developing countries due to the less financial means they have to use. The current situation should therefore also be seen as an opportunity for the INTOSAI community to consider, next slide please, if we could shift a part of our work to more virtual communication and less face-to-face. This would have the effect that a new normal might become the normal with the necessary and the desirable limitations for sure. Next slide, please. So thank you very much, dear colleagues, for your attention, and take care. And again, sorry that you couldn't see me.
Monica, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Patient, I will ask you to mute your mic because we have an echo. Yes, thank you. And yes, it has been proved in our SCEI practice that General Secretariat has been highly responsive and offered lots of support and assistance on any requested matter. All the necessary information and materials are being promptly published on the INTOSAI website. I would like to address your attention to this point. It is important to consistently resort to the use of INTOSAI website and other online resources related to INTOSAI activities. Because even email communication sometimes might not be effective enough. I believe you know it from your own experience. But if you look into the websites, you may find all necessary information if it is properly posted. Which also brings us to the issue mentioned by Monica, a lack of personal contact. So I believe it is not only essential to develop website content, as I've mentioned, but also to enhance its traffic and usage, and also to look for personal contacts, although organized by online means. Now we will proceed to our next speaker, representing the INTOSAI Professional Standards Committee, Ms. Paula Dutra, Director of International Cooperation at Brazilian TCU, Head of PSC Secretariat. She will share the PSC approach to working in distance, but not apart. Paula, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Timur. And hello to my colleagues in the panel and everyone that's watching us today. So when I got the invitation to speak today, I was thinking about what to tell you that was going to be different from what we've just heard and what we're all going through. So I thought I would share with you a little bit about my story in the PSC, going through the meetings, going to some of the meetings in this 7 months that we've been working in distance. We've been doing distance working. So as Timur said, my name is Paula Heblin Dutra, and I currently head the Secretariat of the INTOSAI Professional Standards Committee on behalf of SCEI Brazil, the chair of PSC. So I have been involved with INTOSAI for over 8 years now, four of those in the PSC, not as long as a lot of my colleagues here, but long enough to get used to traveling around and meeting them. So I'm going to tell you the story from going from INTOSAI meeting to INTOSAI meeting. Next slide, please. So I think that the first INTOSAI meeting that went virtual was the FIP meeting, the Forum from INTOSAI Professional Pronouncements, that was to have been in Sofia in Bulgaria in March. The in-person meeting was canceled only 2 or 3 days before I was supposed to board my plane. Of course, besides the logistic nightmare that was to cancel travel arrangements and everything, it was also very frustrating, the idea of not being able to meet in person. There was also a lot of unrest about the pandemic and, of course, apprehension over how much such a meeting could be carried out online. For those of you that don't know, the FIP analyzes and approves new professional pronouncements. So it's quite intensive and long discussions. And doing this online was, well, I would say unimaginable. But turns out it went well, even if had to be interrupted so the FIP chair from Norway would not get stuck in Denmark because of lockdowns. Next slide, please. Of course, all of us in international cooperation were used to online meetings. At the PSC, for example, we had almost weekly meetings with our colleagues at the European Court of Auditors, our vice chairs. But this all seemed like a complicated event involving IT units, tasks, problems with system compatibility, and sometimes bad connection and everything like that. Next slide, please. So the pandemic turns out, and all of this easier. We had to very quickly overcome these challenges, make ourselves familiar with many different online meeting platforms. My personal record was 6 different platforms in one day. SAIs had to figure out their security limitations to use all of these platforms. And well, I, for one, was very happy to have a Skype meeting organized by the GAO Task Force on Strategic Planning instead of their usual teleconferences. So much better. Next slide, please. Another bonus was being able to participate in meetings that I usually don't have an opportunity to attend because someone else in my organization attends. I was very happy to take part in CBC meetings that Johanna will tell you about next. But this was also the case with many others, I think, and as Monica just pointed out. Despite problems with time differences and overbooking, because everyone has a very busy schedule, online meetings expanded access to INTOSAI event and made our inclusiveness motto even more real. Next slide, please. Thinking general and, of course, more at our strategic levels as co-chair, the transition worked well because we have built strong relationships with our colleagues in international cooperation. The cooperation between the co-chairs is a great example of that. Most of us had been working together for a while and had built trust in an amicable relationship. For me, this was key. It was easy to reach out and exchange ideas and plans, and we managed to keep that spirit in the virtual world as well. Next slide, please. But it was a little more difficult with the TSF, the technical support function to INTOSAI standard setting. This was a new group of people that were seconded to work in benefit of INTOSAI in standard setting, providing their technical expertise. The PSC manages the TSF, and we were planning to have the opportunity to have our first in-person meeting in March as the TSF just started their operations. So the TSF was a very new endeavor for us, and establishing an online collaboration without ever having a sit down and some face-to-face time with them, establishing a work routine was definitely more challenging. Next slide, please. We were also limited with our discussions on the review of the framework as mandated by component one of the strategic development plan. In this case, in which more philosophical, controversial, and strategic long-term issues were on the table, I think we would have benefited from a more open and loose discussion without the formality of putting things down on paper. And the steering committee of the PSC was one of the opportunities we envisioned for that kind of discussion. So I guess in a way, this was a limitation. With many meetings being shorter, more objective and recorded, and most of the other work being carried out through email or written submissions, the communication is of course more formal. And for some things, I think we need the benefit of an informal chat over coffee break, lunch, or dinner, so we can dream and think out of the box ideas and solutions. This might be downsides of our current situation, and they might be delaying some initiatives a little, but not deterring your efforts. I feel that the INTOSAI community in general has such a strong bond that can carry through in the virtual world as we adapt and go through these crazy times together. Next slide, please. There's a beautiful word in Portuguese that can translate into other languages, and that is saudade. It refers to this melancholic longing or yearning, a feeling of incompleteness. And as we go through this challenging and uncertain times, we all feel the longing to meet again and laughing over great ideas, coffee, or something stronger. And here in Brazil, we're hoping this will happen in time for INTOSAI 2022. The Congress will be held in Rio de Janeiro, and the best symbol of Rio, one of the seven wards of the Mother World, is Christ the Redeemer. He has his arms open, hugging the city of Rio and welcoming all its visitors. And that is what we hope the Congress in 2022 will represent. Our opportunity to meet again after hard times and routine dollar spirit of cooperation and friendship, and that we kept going in the virtual world. Waiting for better times to come again. I can't wait to be able to meet my colleagues again and sit down for a long chat over coffee. Next slide, please. Thank you so much. Have a good day, everyone. Thank you, Timor.
Thank you, Paulo. And yes, thank you so much, first of all, for sharing your feelings on this new normal, the surprise, the frustration and uncertainty that you mentioned. And I fully agree that strong relations among all of us is the key to successful continuation of work. I would add also to your presentation probably the paperless events that we have in this new format. And yes, we truly hope that when the time comes for the INCOSAI in Brazil, we will be able to meet face to face. Dear colleagues, I would like to seize the opportunity of being a moderator and ask you the first question for our traditional communication with the audience. How do you assess the experience of your SCEI related to participating in INTOSAI activities during the pandemic? So please follow the link in the chat box or use this QR for answering this question. And by the end of the meeting, we will see the results and we'll have some time for discussion on this. Our next speaker will tell us about INTOSAI Capacity Building Committee vision on how to make lemonade out of lemons. I'm glad to welcome Ms. Johanna Gardmark, Project Director in Swedish National Audit Office, representative of CBC Secretariat. Johanna, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Timur, and hello to everyone. I hope you are familiar with the saying of when life gives you lemons, make lemonade, because this is what CBC has tried to do throughout the year. And I realize that this somewhat optimistic title of making lemonades with lemons may seem inappropriate in a pandemic. So I would like to start by recognizing the real and serious damage caused by COVID-19, the overwhelming numbers of lives lost, the financial consequences, and the societies affected in many different ways. And from a personal perspective and from a CBC perspective, I will be the first to say that if anyone before March this year had suggested that the CBC should conduct its business entirely online, I would have thought it was a very, very bad idea. Next slide, please. Having said this, we found ourselves at the beginning of this year having to cancel our first physical meeting. Like Paula said, that involved a lot of practical aspects and a lot of frustration. The goal chairs had planned to meet in Stockholm for strategic discussions with each other and with the FIP leadership. And while we had to rethink our entire approach and started extensive discussions by email and multiple virtual meetings between the goal chairs, we also followed developments worldwide and came to the realization that we needed to rethink our plans for the year and come up with a long-term strategy to deal with CBC activities. Sorry. The CBC Secretariat suggested a few alternative approaches to the chair and vice chair, but they were in complete agreement that we needed to move ahead with a digital strategy. While the CBC work streams each managed their own processes, the CBC Secretariat focused on making the plans for the annual meeting into several online events. In June, we organized webinars on the theme of SCEI capacity, performance, and relevance during and subsequent to COVID-19, and another one on the cooperation between SCEIs and civil society organizations. The second one was the planned theme of our annual meeting that was supposed to take place in a physical format in September. Instead, in September, we held a virtual steering committee meeting. And then in October, what was originally our plan for a regional forum for capacity development was turned into a webinar on SCEI's audit of donor funds. Looking back on this experience, we have learned quite a lot. As the CBC chair is in South Africa and the vice chair is in Sweden, we have always had a joint virtual secretariat. And on that level, we're very used to finding virtual solutions to cooperation. But working with the full committee and external stakeholders, that was a different story. So starting with the positive, next slide, please. We quickly found some great advantages with our digital solutions. CBC meetings generally attract close to 100 of CBC's members and stakeholders, but working digitally, we had a much broader reach and we were able to be much more inclusive, like Monica mentioned. We had between 100 and 200 participants in each webinar and with a much greater variety than we would normally have. there was a broader geographical spread, and participants included not only CBC members, but also other INTOSAI members and quite a number of external stakeholders, such as civil society organizations and representatives of our donor community. The fact that we turned what would normally be a three-day physical event with several different topics into a separate single topic event gave us both flexibility and focus. Next slide, please. Oh, sorry. It wasn't next slide. Back one. Apologies. So from a flexibility perspective, we managed to organize our first webinars within about 6 weeks of deciding to go virtual. When no one needs to book a venue or a flight, both speakers and participants are more easily available. And when the time commitment for a speaker is 2 hours, not several days, even some very busy people can make time to contribute, which has been wonderful for us. When taking on one topic at a time, we give both ourselves and the audience a better focus on the issue. The audience has a chance to pick and choose the webinars they're interested in and don't need to commit more than a couple of hours at a time. With good moderators and variety of speakers and interaction with the audience, we have also been able to drill down on different topics. Another advantage is that organizing multiple events rather than one big annual meeting has made the CBC more visible throughout the year, and we've had more continuous engagement with a number of our stakeholders. Follow-up is also easier, as we have been able to address questions generated in the webinars by sharing replies on the CBC website. And finally, again, I think Monica mentioned this, enormous savings have been made both financially and the environmental cost of organizing meetings. We are not spending time and money organizing the practical aspects of a meeting, and we're not flying hundreds of auditors around the world to attend meetings, which we are now able to organize in a virtual form. Now, next slide. So, of course, not everything is wonderful with this new way of working. Even with the best of intentions, true engagement and interaction is difficult in a virtual format. To some extent, it's difficult just because there are so many participants. So you need to strictly manage the interaction, to manage time and the structure of the event. And this would have been an issue even in a large physical meeting, but it does become more mechanical in a virtual format. The webinar format is also impersonal, almost by definition. There's no way for a speaker to, or for a moderator to read the room and know if the message is hitting home, if people need a break or are falling asleep. And as a speaker, it can be very difficult when you can't read the body language of your audience. You can easily feel like you're speaking into an empty void, staring at your own screen. Last but not least, some of the most important aspects of our physical meetings, which I think both Monica and Paula touched on, is the networking and the relationship building. It just isn't the same in a virtual format. So many of us are lucky to have worked together for a long time and can at least somewhat easily move an existing professional relationship into a virtual platform. But building new relationships just is not doable in the same way. Next slide, please. So I would like to close with some reflections on key success factors which the CBC found in making this transition into working virtually. First of all, virtual engagements require meticulous planning and prior consultation, or you risk wasting your stakeholders' time. Even more than a physical meeting, you need to stage manage the event to make sure you keep the audience's attention and stay on topic. There's a clear time limit of a virtual event. Going beyond 2 hours is strenuous for speakers and participants, as well as for organizers. We have all had to develop some new skills, as we need the technical proficiency to get the most out of difficult virtual platforms. Although I have to admit that Paula has me beaten with her six different platforms in one day. I can't match that. here, the CBC realized our limitations and we brought in professionals to assist by engaging a company to manage the technical aspects of our webinars. And that was a good investment. They helped us both save time and professionalize the events. As webinars are relatively easy to organize, many people are doing it, and many organizations are doing it, both inside INTOSAI and outside. And as a result, effective communication or even promotion of the webinars is essential to not get lost in the shuffle. And as a final reflection on that aspect, perhaps we need to manage our own ambition a bit and be careful not to overdo it. Or we risk overloading our members and stakeholders with too many events competing with one another. So for the CBC, this has been an educational year, and I hope we can build on a lot of the lessons we have learned, even when we are allowed to travel again. And hopefully we can achieve a better balance between the physical and virtual meetings in the future, saving both money and environment while actually gaining something professionally in the process. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Johanna. Indeed, current situation has its pros. You made a good point calling it lemonade, and cons, which are lemons. And thank you for mentioning this low-hanging lemons and indicating the problems that we are facing. And I think we still have room for development online formats for organizing the events. I believe that so a kind of combination could give us a surplus in meetings and discussions and having new information and experience. So thank you so much for lemonade. So before we move to our next speaker, let me remind you that if you have questions to our speakers, feel free to send them to the chat. And now I would like to give the floor to the representative of INTOSAI Knowledge Sharing Committee, Mr. Kurvan Singh, Principal Director and Head of International Relations in the Office of the Controller and Auditor General of India. His presentation focuses on COVID-19, changed workplace dynamics, building and fostering an agile and responsive culture. Kurvan, please, the floor is yours. We don't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Timur. Distinguished panelists, participants, my dear colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen. I'll begin by thanking the Supervisory Committee on Emerging Issues for giving us this opportunity to converse our thoughts, initiatives, and opinions on how do we think about teleconferencing and share our experiences in how we have seen the transition, transformation, and restructuring of our work in the past few months. I would like to take the presentations given by Monica, Paula, and Johanna further with and like to add our experiences on building and fostering an agile and responsive culture. Ladies and gentlemen, I would be reflecting my thoughts from both SCEI as well as SCEI India's perspective. And I would like to inform how KSC Chair, we could use our own size, experience and challenges during the pandemic, work on focus areas and strategies of KSC. All of us are reeling under the impact of coronavirus. And as rightly pointed out by previous panelist speakers, that we don't know, adding to our woes is the fact that we don't know when is this going to end. And the eventual impact of it, the impact it would have on people, on us, on businesses, on organizations, and on global economy. And the pandemic has compounded the already formidable challenges of business continuity and organizational transformation. Based on this, that is why we thought we will discuss on changing workplace dynamics. COVID-19 has catapulted us to, in my opinion, around 5 to 10 years in our digital future. The pace which has accelerated. But organizations recognize that they must do more than digitize their strategy and operating model and amp up their employees' digital fluency. Organizations must figure this all out while charting a strategic roadmap for a truly unpredictable future. This is transformation for the post-pandemic era. We also have to look into when we restart, what will be the post-pandemic era. Most importantly, I would like to discuss that central to all these issues are our people, our human resources, our staff, our auditors, our employees, for whom the COVID-19 has turned things upside down in virtually every respect, not only in meetings. Apart from anxiety over the disease, which full effects remain unclear, people are absolutely worried about safety measures in their workplaces, job security, complexity and distractions of working from home, their family well-being and their additional demands on their family life, among other issues. Seemingly overnight, many have found themselves navigating new technologies and ways of working. This monumental degree of change and uncertainty has extracted a tremendous psychological toll. I would be sharing along with you quickly on what KSC and SCEI India perspective is. What is the impact of disruption? We can draw comfort for one thing, as we call it, IT is a positive disruption. One positive disruption it has brought along is that it is pushing us to rethink the current approaches. It is also pushing us or reigniting us to look at things very differently and explore unexplored options. Also helping us in trimming and fine-tuning existing approaches. In today's context, I would be touching upon the following four issues. One is, what were the dynamics that ASC and SCEI India handled the changing workplace? Second is leading during disruption. How did we effectively react and responded to the crisis? Third is about focus areas while we were dealing with the disruption. And finally, how we were able to or are struggling to mitigate the challenges. Part one is, I would like to spend a while here on, though the pandemic started somewhere in late December 2019, however, till February 2020, the activities of KSC and its working groups were on its normal lines. But only from March 20, the world took a massive hit, and so did INTOSAI and SCEI, and so did was KSC and y'all. As members are aware, the KSC builds on essential features of sharing and cooperation that have been INTOSAI's hallmark through the years. The strategic objective of KSC are achieved through its working groups. In real sense, the work started from June onwards. I'll quickly take you through that. We started holding steering committee meetings online using Zoom facility in INTOSAI community portal, which came very handy to us and to all members. Similarly, virtual meetings also became norm. A few of them, like SDG and key sustainable development indicators, and working group on impact and science and technology held their meetings. Working group on public debt under the theme implementation of SDGs, exploring the role of public debt auditors in light of COVID-19. And the meeting saw presentations from five SCEI bringing out their perspective on the theme. The working group is also intended to include the other activities to ascertain the implication. Similarly, working group on big data conducted its meeting virtually, where all administrative and other issues were discussed. Most importantly, an interesting presentation was given by SCEI Brazil on how to use technology and data to audit COVID-19 related purchases. In the annual meeting of working group on extractive industries, four SCEI shared their experiences on lessons learned from COVID-19. Apart from this, AfroSCEI made a presentation on effect of COVID-19 on extractive industries, way forward for the auditors. Working groups like IT audit, big data, evaluation of public program and policies conducted their webinars. IT working group on IT audit conducted a webinar where SCEI shares their experience in the IT audit field. Ajita also conducted its first quarterly webinar on GEO's IT and cybersecurity audit work on the 2020 United States Census. In fact, we are looking forward to a global webinar on strengthening digital awareness, IT audit, learning audit guidance, which is scheduled to be in the first week of November. Similarly, Working Group on Environment Audit adopted innovative concepts on developing MOOCs, their massive online open courses on various subjects related to environmental auditing and support capacity building activities. WGFMRR held a special meeting in May 20 and also planned their work related to COVID-19. We noticed that these platforms commonly used were Zoom, Microsoft Teams, Blackboard Meetings, Amazon Chime. On the last bullet, we think that we foresee also that this new work dynamics will continue for long. Now, this long is a big question for anybody guess, but to my understanding, the three things make it long. I think because there is no clarity on when the disruption will end, the majority of people and the groups and the countries around the world are increasingly adopting the means, and they may become normal operating mode. Second, we think it is also value for organizations. Adaptness in using online technologies saves costs, travel and time. The key benefits are the lesser infrastructure cost. And to my mind, the most important point here is that there is a ability to attract talent across offices, across geographies, across continents. You have a wider, suddenly you get a wider and wider pool of sources and resources from where you can collaborate, converge, discuss, enrich yourself, and share the knowledge. It is also anticipated that there would be a lesser number of absences and the higher productivity whenever the outcomes or the impact will be measured, if at all. Finally, it is also very long. It could be long because of the value for the employees, because less time wasted on commute, they can be more focused where there are less distractions, plus they have room to handle their work-life balances. The maturity of automation systems will also enhance productivity. Moving on, we found that leading through disruption, how KSC effectively reacted and responded to the crisis. Our strategic objective, one of the things that SCEI needs to be mindful during a crisis of this epic proportion is the need to be flexible and agile. The strategic objective of goal 3 is to work along with the working groups and refinement of results working along with the working groups, project teams, community of practices, etc. KSC community portal came quite handy during the crisis. The Zoom facility in the portal has been widely used by the KSC and its working group. The community of practices, the 18 community of practices featured, enabled the auditors to continue their experience sharing. One recently which we have started is on community of practice on SDGs. As the SCEIs realign and readapt to their new dynamics, the contributions of managers and leaders is critical for success. Rather, very critical for success. They can lead the change management initiative to help the employees and organizations respond to better crisis. INTOSAI can help SCEIs to work on enabling and empowering them in change dynamics. For example, KSC research paper on disaster preparedness for SCEI provides an excellent reference for SCEIs to understand basic concept of disaster preparedness, besides governments and related parties' efforts, policies, funding mechanism. Consolidated GID 5330 on auditing disaster management is planning to endorse in 74 GB. KSC actively coordinated with PFAC COVID-19 initiative. Surplus fund allocated to KSC were diverted to INTOSAI efforts. Providing link to PFAC page on lesson learned for the portal. Creating a library of information and also using KSC as an expert group member in SCEI initiatives on COVID-19. We are continuously engaging with our working groups and project teams. Also collaborating with IDI on rolling out 3D audits on resilience of national public health systems across INTOSAI nations. Most importantly, we are looking to We are also developing IFPP and non-IFPP projects. Currently, around 24 non-IFPP products are currently under different stages of development. Working on future, a crisis of this dimension, we think that needs ongoing crisis management. As the dynamic shifts in the longer run, so the need should come up with supporting measures that can help the organizations deal with it. The virtual platform in the portal is being continuously improved. For its features, new features are added to enhance its user experience and user interaction. What were our focus area? I'll just spend a minute on this, please. In the midst of this dynamic, changing dynamics, disruption, let us examine what should we do further. COVID-19 outbreak has clearly changed the way SCEIs need to work and has extension how to build the required skill sets. In fact, it will lead to changed workplace in our opinion. COVID-19 outbreak has clearly changed the way we need to work and has an extension how we build the required skill sets. And similarly, working groups have the work to enhance the auditee and stakeholder interactions and expectations and assesses what further measures we warranted to strengthen remote teams output. We also need to bring out effective solutions, to practical solutions rather, to model and enable SCEIs to continue their operations and be effective for their societies. To sum up, enabling building agile, forward-looking, inclusive and resilient SCEIs through strategic planning and management. I would just mention four strategies which we thought are the lesson learned for us. One, it is important to have an agile and multi-pronged approach to generate and share knowledge and tool on remote auditing, workflow automations, and teleworking. These are very important tools with us. We should help people enable to, by themselves, train them so that they can use it in these multi-pronged approaches. Second is to review the current delivery and adapt, realign it to match the current needs of SCEIs with the cooperation of PSC and CBC and to facilitate collaborative or social learning. We also learned that to provide options to maximize the available budget, because in the coming years, we presume that the financial impacts will be of the COVID are also similar as to the impact of just not only traveling abroad. And to facilitate the working group deliveries into the shorter run time. Finally, in this journey, a crucial aspect is to maintain focus on not just the knowledge sharing, skill development, or identification of gaps, but also to keep an eye on impact assessment to assess effectiveness and continuous evaluation. Coming back to SCEI India, how did we happened to take this long in our strides? While we responded with various measures to protect the staff as were given by our local governments and government of India, but most importantly, we went into work from home, promoted teleworking like in all other countries, on all other sites, and management of applications and staggering working hours. We promoted team management applications and staggered our working hours. And we adopted new audit techniques like better and innovative data analytic models, where we collated data from various departments to ensure continuation of audit activities despite the disruption to add value to government governance process, both nationally as well as internationally. The three golden rules we followed as with our government was like in all to wear mask, to wash hygiene, and to maintain social distance from everyone. Few important things which helped us to react positively in this was communication. Our heads of provincial offices were given directions to keep the communication channels open with the employees during work from home, call them to inquire about their work, and share their experiences during the crisis. And this practice supports positive mental well-being and promotes output, we believe, and we found also. Second was the audit approach, which was adopted was agile. Data sets from various departments and planning commissions being analyzed, and the data analytics cells and teams were assisted to do audit, more focused auditing in limited interaction with the auditee organization. In other sense, it was more of a desk audit than a field audit. Based on the results of the desk audit, we will sample, and as the situation improves, whenever we will do our field audits. Work on future, we have also understood to match the crisis of this dimension and the shift, we have adopted a complete e-office module and has re-engineered the entire office procedure online. Most importantly, we have developed an indigenous One India, One System end-to-end web-based workflow automation for the entire process, covering from audit planning, programming, field audit reporting, and as a document management system. Finally, we leased on a big project on capacity development program, and we did it overall in an important way. And we started opening our training portal to cater both administrative as well as learning activities. Two things we thought about. I would take your time to the important to the second point of it, that we wanted to audit. We now are going to audit the procurement of drugs and equipment during the COVID-19 pandemic. And it's an horizontal audit covering all provinces. The objectives of audit is to assess whether the procurement agencies were able to meet demands of drugs, equipment, consumables during the COVID-19 pandemic. It will be covered in two phases. Basically, what all we learned during our work from home as well as from our teleworking and desk reviews, we'll be implementing them now in piecemeals. As I mentioned, it will be in two phases. Phase one will be planning involving data analytics, and followed by phase two involving field audits. Next, please. We believe here, finally, that that the impact of COVID-19 on organizations is real. We believe that we have to now look into the phase two of it, how we are going to restart, how we are going to look at restructuring in terms of post-COVID restructuring, how we are going to maintain that business continuity, and whether we will be now, like for example, based on the results of the SCEI working paper and other working groups, what will be the new norm, whether it is going to be completely online, whether it is going to be hybrid, or it is going to back to the normal. So these are the important things which leadership has to look into, and so that there is a clear direction amongst us as an INTOSAI auditing community that what lies ahead for us. But this doesn't mean that we have to panic. As I mentioned, being prepared and showing resilience is vital. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much, Kulwant, for sharing with us your experience. And you have demonstrated a good example of prompt response and integrating new strategies from the perspective both the committee and your side. Dear colleagues, please pay attention to the ongoing survey that we have right now, and so please pay attention to the chat, and you'll find the link to this survey. And now it is time for the presentation of the INTOSAI Political, Financial and Administrative Committee. Please welcome Ms. Manal Al-Duhaimi, International Relations Officer in General Court of Audit of Saudi Arabia. Today she will tell us about the PFAC, how PFAC was operating during the pandemic. Now, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Tamar. I'm not sure if I'm visible, but I hope my voice is clear.
It's okay.
Dear colleagues and participants of this webinar, my name is Manal Al-Duhaimi from SCEI Saudi Arabia. I'll be representing the PFAC, the Policy, Finance and Administration Committee. I'll be providing you with the story of the PFAC in dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic. Before I can start, I want to thank the Supervisory Committee and Emerging Issues for arranging this valuable webinar. We have heard great presentations already, and we at the PC can relate very much. And I may sound repetitive once pinpointing into some of the tools and challenges that we used and faced to adapt to the new normal. So thank you to my fellow speakers for your constructive and interesting presentation. Please, would you like to present my slides? Because I can't see them.
Your slides are displayed. Please go ahead.
Okay, next slide, please. I'll be presenting the PFAC experience and efforts in dealing with this pandemic through the transition to remote working. So, therefore, I'll be looking at the tools and platforms, as well as the PFAC COVID initiative, the INTOSAI COVID-19 website, as well as the high-level lessons learned documents that was developed and the guidance on remote working documents. I'll also look at the INTOSAI Emergency Fund in a more developed way, and then we'll look into the challenges that we have faced and how did the PFAC leadership overcome these challenges. Next slide, please. So what are the tools and platforms used at the PFAC? Similarly to my fellow colleagues, the PFAC operations were continued remotely via the use of various platforms. We have used, for example, Skype for Business to arrange meetings between the leadership on concrete decisions, such as the PFAC COVID-19 initiative kickoff meeting. We have used Cisco WebEx for the IDSC 13 meeting, and we have used Amazon Chime for the PFAC 17 meeting, as well as Zoom for a larger meeting group on various topics, and many other popular platforms were also used. Next slide, please.
Manal, we don't hear you.
Has established the COVID-19 initiative in April 2020 as a short-term initiative to help SCEIs around the world to continue their operations in order to serve their citizens and government. Next slide, please. The COVID-19 initiative focused on maintaining continuity of operations within INTOSAI and assisting individual sites with their continuity of operation, as well as sharing practical, technical, and audited related information across INTOSAI members. It has also developed a high-level lessons learned document in order to minimize similar situations in the future. Next slide, please. So a key component of this initiative is a dedicated website, the INTOSAI COVID-19.org website, that went live on May 2020, which includes a variety of timely and useful resources for the INTOSAI members. The website contains links to resources on remote work, the use of technology for virtual meetings, real-time auditing and staff training, amongst many other resources. In addition, the website has information on relevant audit findings and methodologies on topics such as pandemic prevention, preparedness, and response. Past audit related to disease outbreak, system, financial market, and expenditures related to COVID-19. As of October 13, 2020, the website has been visited by over 13,000 users with over 17,700 page views. PFAC greatly appreciate contributions for content for the website from across INTOSAI. Next slide, please. In addition to the website, the PFAC COVID-19 initiative developed a high-level lessons learned document for external stakeholders such as the United Nations and the World Health Organization that focuses on minimizing similar situation in the future. with an emphasis on action that could be taken to limit the spread of disease via aviation. So we'd encourage you guys to visit the website and have a look and download the lessons learned document at the INTOSAI COVID-19.org website. So at the September PFAC 17th meeting committee, committee members approved the lessons learned document, and we are now working to engage with INTOSAI and relevant stakeholders, external audience. We are coordinating this effort with the INTOSAI chair, the general secretariat, and other key INTOSAI partners. Next, please. Furthermore, the COVID-19 initiative provides many tools to help the INTOSAI community in continuing their operations remotely. A developed guidance on remote working in all INTOSAI language is available on the website. The guidance provides helpful solutions and directions on how to determine the appropriate platform for your virtual meeting and how to prepare a meeting agenda and plan for a short focused meeting, as well as how to, for example, prepare your meeting materials in advance of the meeting. We encourage all members' sites to download the guidance among other resources from the INTOSAI COVID-19 website, and you can find it under the INTOSAI resources. Before I can conclude this session, the PFAC leadership agreed to include the short-term COVID-19 initiative in the September PFAC meeting and is in the process of transitioning the website and related efforts to the Supervisory Committee on Emerging Issues, which is undertaking a longer-term COVID-19 effort focused on strategic foresight and developing recommendations for the governing board. The PFAC has coordinated extensively with the Accounts Chamber of the Russian Federation on this transition and participated in related SCEI webinars. We greatly appreciate the collaborations with the SCEI and look forward to continuing this engagement and ensuring seamless transition. Next slide, please. Furthermore, to the efforts of the PFAC and recognizing the impact that the pandemic had on continuity of operations among many INTOSAI members, the PFAC leadership consulted with the General Secretariat about the availability of the INTOSAI surplus funds and determined that none had been requested or spent by the goal chair. So I want to take this opportunity to thank the PSC, the CBC, the KSC, and the INTOSAI General Secretariat for relocating this fund. That's up to 7,100 euros in INTOSAI funds to support SCEIs greatly affected by the pandemic was dedicated as an emergency fund. The PFAC leadership sought and received PFAC and governing board approval to direct these funds towards assisting SCEIs with acquiring necessary information, technology, and related softwares. In October, the grant announcement was published on INTOSAI donor corporations websites and committed to INTOSAI regional organizations and SCEIs, and the application template is available in INTOSAI official languages. The first round of funding will begin very soon, in October 31st, 2020. Applications will be received on rolling basis monthly thereafter. Currently, it is under process and we have received many interested SCEIs and will be receiving even more. Next slide, please. Now looking at the challenges that the PFAC have faced during the remote working. Fortunately and frankly speaking, the PFAC leadership was not impacted by this pandemic substantially. However, common issues are unavoidable and inevitable, such as finding translation assistance during the meeting and the webinars, for example, technology unpredictability and the interference of audience, expenses, as I may sound a bit different than to my colleagues. They have mentioned that it's less expensive, whereas we think that sometimes using an outsourcing to organize some webinars, some larger webinars, could be more expensive. Also, ensuring virtual meetings have a lively atmosphere where all are encouraged to participate, while also recognizing that virtual meeting must be much shorter than in-person meeting, and that decision point must be made efficiently. Next slide, please. Before I can conclude, I'd like to also mention the how the leadership of the PFAC have overcome these challenges. And regardless of the challenges and difficulties in working remotely, I have demonstrated in this presentation, it is evident that the PFAC has effectively done its work virtually through meetings of the initiative with Dr. Al-Angari and Mr. Dodaro. As virtual votes of JV members were also conveyed, for example, on the SCEI grant proposal, communicating frequently with committee members to build alignment and consensus. So I'd like to end my presentation and thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Manal. Thank you so much for your presentation. And we should notice that PFAC managed to collect a solid database of INTOSAI and SCEI resources. And I'm sure that the whole INTOSAI community will thoroughly study. Dear colleagues, thank you for your questions that we have in the chat. And I invite you to continue in asking the speakers. As I have mentioned, we also have individual SCEIs which would like to give their brief comments and overviews today. Dear colleagues, I would like to ask you or remind you that your comments should be up to 5 minutes. And we will start with SCEI of Italy. And let me introduce Mr. Benedetta Brancoli-Buzdraghi, judge of the Chamber for Liguria, and Ms. Erica Guerri, judge at the Second Chamber of Appeal, deputy head of the International Affairs Office. So, colleagues, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. And I am Benedetto Brancoli-Buzdraghi. I'm glad to be here. I will just steal some minutes just to share some impressions about what we have achieved during the latest months, and it seems to me that we have all been doing very well under the current situation. Now, can I kindly ask to move directly to slide number 2, if possible? Yeah, exactly. Well, I don't know whether you are familiar or not with Fred the Penguin, and Fred is the main character of a novel by John Cotter, professor at the Harvard Business of Economics, Business Economics Economic School, and he basically writes a novel about a penguin that finds out that his iceberg is melting. So either he will manage to convince his colony to move to another iceberg very soon, or his colony is likely to disappear very, very soon. Now, I think that in a way, this is also what we have been called upon to achieve in the latest month. So either we change our way of working, or we might lose something, we might miss the chance to cooperate and work effectively. And in this regard, if I may, I think that we have been doing very well. We have taken the chance and opportunity to change our way of working. Still, I would have some minor suggestions on how to improve our way of working together, if I may. Can I ask to move to the next slide, please? Yeah, thank you very much. So, well, in our view, there are some things that are very good. For example, we have appreciated very much the participants' commitment and also the level of knowledge sharing. It has been very useful to us to exchange thoughts and feelings and methodologies also on a bilateral basis, I would say. So I think that this has been really an asset during the course of the pandemic for SCEI Italy. Nonetheless, it seems to me, as per the content of our meeting, that still video conferences do not allow the same level of interaction as physical meetings. And in this regard, there might be a threat of losing something in terms of brainstorming and capability challenge. And I think that this type of dialogue is very useful and fruitful. So this is something that we should maybe pay attention on. And eventually, I find very useful the Russian practice, for example, of introducing quick surveys, like also today you have done with the Mentimeter. I think that this type of suggestions and surveys are very useful to foster attention and dialogue, as otherwise it would be very difficult to dialogue. coming to device, well, to be honest, Corte dei Conti has invested a huge amount of money in the latest 10 years in IT infrastructure. So as per devices and infrastructures, to be honest, we have had no criticalities of any kind on anything. Still, it seems to us that some softwares would allow better interaction, and in this regard, our personal feeling is that BB Collab, the software that we are using now, the platform we are using now for this conference, works very well, while maybe we've had some problems with Amazon Chime. Maybe it was not as simple as BB Collaborate. So in our view, the simpler is better. And but it's just a suggestion. I mean, maybe somebody else have different feelings. So finally, can I ask you to move to the next slide? Yep, thank you very much. Well, a couple of suggestions. We are in a very busy world, and indeed, we have several conference calls because the opportunity to meet by video conference has also encouraged people to have this type of meeting. So it is more, it is getting increasingly difficult to fix agendas and to plan meetings. So maybe we were wondering if it wouldn't be a good idea to allot a fixed recurring day for meetings, for example, the first Monday of the month or the last Friday of the second decade. Just a suggestion, but this could probably help to organize agendas. And well, another suggestion would be to create an INTOSAI who's who, because we have been working together for, well, I've been working for INTOSAI only for less than 1 year. So maybe, probably most of you don't know me. And I think it would be interesting to have an INTOSAI who's who, to know who you're talking with, and to have maybe eventual also direct contact for the other colleagues of INTOSAI. Slide, please. So thank you very much. That is all for the moment from INTOSAI, from SCEI Italy. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much. And first of all, thank you for reminding us Corte's book. I think so your suggestion available specifically in this context, ice is melting, so we can take them into account while preparing the recommendations. And now we will proceed to SCEI of Czech Republic. We all know that our Czech colleagues experienced some extra challenges in postponing EuroSCEI Congress, but still managed to keep everyone engaged into preparation process. So I'd like to give the floor to Mr. Yaroslav Ruski, international relations expert, and Ms. Yana Gabrielova, spokesperson. So colleagues, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Timur, for giving us the floor. I and my colleague are going to inform you about the communication tools in our office and how the pandemic affected the organization of EuroSCEI Congress in Prague. Yes, next slide, please. As it has been said by many speakers before me, even our office had to find new communication channels for communication with our colleagues in the office and external communication with international colleagues. So I would like to tell you how we moved to the online world. Next slide. Before the outbreak of pandemic, our office used mainly the intranet and Microsoft SharePoint, which served mainly for our auditors, for they were able to share their documents from auditing, and they stored confidential data there. But during the pandemic, we had to find more interactive tools. And so we have been using these three, Google Duo, Microsoft Teams, and GoToMeeting. And we use them according to the number of participants and the purpose of the meeting. We have also the license for organizing meetings for all three tools. Next slide, please. So the first is Google Duo. We use it mainly for language learning because the the number of participants is limited, only for four. But the great advantage is that you don't need your laptop, you just use it on your mobile phone. So so when someone's out of office or outside, we are able still to communicate and see each other. Next slide. Microsoft Teams is another tool which we use for our internal communication, mainly for larger groups when we need to share the sound and the video, when we share our documents. And but we mainly use the tool of chat. We have created many teams on Microsoft Teams, and the first team was the team for Congress, because we were supposed to hold the Congress in May in Prague. So thanks to this channel, we were able to communicate with our colleagues in the office, because a vast majority of colleagues is actively involved in the organization of EuroSCEI. And we were able to share our documents there, inform them about our approach to the organization, and then the postponement. Next slide, please. Then we use our GoToMeeting tool. We use it mainly for big events or international meetings with our partners from abroad. Because the main advantage of this is that we can see your colleagues on the screen at the same time. It's the screens are not limited. And for example, we have used a GoToMeeting tool for EuroSCEI governing board meetings or coordination team meetings. So this tool has proved well. Also, we have been vastly using Blackboard, which we're using right now for events. Next slide, please. For auditors, there is a platform for sharing experience and data. It's called BEEP. It's run by our office. And just very briefly, BEEP has become the primary knowledge sharing platform for the EuroSCEI project group on PG on COVID-19. Next slide. As for the technical equipment, every employee has his or her own laptop. So now we are in the home office mode. And of course, and also colleagues from the IT department have designed video conferencing kits, which you can see in the picture right on the right. We use it mainly when the number of participants is limited due to the online rooms. And so we are able to use one room, but for example, 10 our colleagues are able to join the online meeting and be active. So this is it from my side, and now I would like to give the floor to my colleague Jana.
Thank you, Jurek. And I would like to just briefly inform you about how we are communicating with the Congress participants, with our colleagues from EuroSCEI, just during these challenging times. Because we accept the official communication, we communicate on social media platforms, especially on Twitter and Instagram, because we want to keep our participants up to date and to communicate with them also less formal. So we prepared a special Congress campaign, which was organized for the time the Congress was due to take place. Next slide, please. Thank you. So the main message of the campaign was that we were supposed to be here in Prague, in a Congress, but everything is different now. The time has changed, our work has changed, our activities has changed, and we want to show to other colleagues not only how our work was changed, but also our other activities, which we adopted during these challenging times, especially our volunteering activities, like we offered our older computers to the schools and children in need, for example, our colleagues used face masks and so on. And we also wanted to share with other colleagues on social media from other Supreme Audit Institutions from EuroSCEI and call them to action, that let's share with us what you are doing during these challenging times, what are your activities, and for example, what kind of volunteering activities, if there are any, you are doing. So we received from 14 Supreme Audit Institutions from your side the answers. For example, the colleagues from Lithuania sent us this picture from the with the colleagues who was helping at a mobile testing unit in Vilnius. But we also received many information from other colleagues from other sites, how they changed their work, what kind of audits they are created, which are connected to the COVID-19 topic, and so on. Next slide, please. And we were also using our special Congress website. We used this already before these challenging times, but we also changed the content on this website, and we also changed the website address to EuroSci 2021, because we have to postpone the Congress to the next year. And we also we are also sharing the content which is connected to the campaign and more detailed information which we received from other colleagues. What are they doing during these challenging times? So it was everything for me. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact us or on our email addresses.
Colleagues, thank you so much. And we really like the new Congress logo. And thank you for giving evaluation of the tools you have used. I think it is useful for everyone to try different tools and share. So anyone can find something for themselves. All in all, like Paul used to use six of different platforms in one time. We have one more comment left. Finally, I welcome Mr. Kavahar Ali Asdi, Director General in the Department of the Auditor General of Pakistan, who will share the experience in conducting audit in the new normal. And let me remind you about the time limit for the comment. So please, the floor is yours. Yes, please.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much to all the participants and
I'm sorry, but we don't hear you. Yeah, now it's okay.
Am I audible?
Now it's okay, so please go ahead.
Thank you. Good evening to all the honorable participants of the SCEI expert group. Representing SCEI Pakistan, I am Tafakkur Ali Asdi, Director General Federal Audit, and I would like to extend my thanks to Mr. Taimur from the Accounts Chamber of the Russian Federation for providing SCEI Pakistan an opportunity to share our experience on auditing in the new normal. The pandemic of COVID-19 hit Pakistan in February 2020. The government of Pakistan's effective management and preemptive actions stand out in the region in handling the COVID-19 successfully, and we reduced the loss to the minimum. The Auditor General of Pakistan also very timely realized the challenges that could be confronted to audit in the new normal, and the same was kept in mind while we planned our audits for the month of April onwards. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Can we move to the next slide, please? Am I audible? Can we move?
Yes, please go on. So, dear colleagues, we'll try once more to connect Mr. Tafkar once again. If not, then we will proceed to the questions, or to at least some of the questions that we got from the audience. Just a few seconds. Okay, we'll wait for a few seconds more, and I would like to invite the audience for the second question, if you don't mind. Yes, for the second questions, by this I would like to start this now very shortened version of the Q&A session within this webinar. And we have discussed many times, is there any need within INTOSAI for working group on auditing healthcare? So the INTOSAI working group on evaluation of public policies and programs already covers health related matters. However, when the pandemic happened, the topic gained a broader range. So that is why we have this question, and we kindly invite you to answer the question. Please follow the link in the chat box. Use your phone camera to download this link with the QR scanner. So I see Mr. Tafkar reconnected.
Yes, am I audible?
Yes, please. So may I ask you to move to some conclusions and the
sure,
major
sure.
ideas.
I'll be very crisp. Next slide, please. So conducting fieldwork from home office proved to be a challenge. Yet a novel idea, because auditors are not trained to work from home. So it was difficult to collect sufficient evidence. There are mobility restrictions that have been talked in detail by Ms. Johanna from Sweden, and then limited interaction with the audit team. There was non-availability of staff in the auditee's organization. And then first-hand observation cannot be replaced by the virtual auditing. So these were the challenges. Next, please. Next slide. So what we did, we started with a participatory approach. We wrote letters to all the heads of organization and obtained what they want to be audited the most. Then we commissioned special workshops for conducting audit in new normal. And as many colleagues said, we reduced the audit load by doing the effective desk audit. And then you use the technical tool to access your laptops in the through teleworking. And we requisition the report to, so that we can save. Then we reduce the audit and became more focused in audit. So can we then we ensured social distancing and rotation policy for this and focused on systemic issues rather going into the audit. Also, we focus on trend analysis of the last 4 years and then predict for the fifth year, which was the year hit by the COVID-19. Next slide, please. Then we started supervisory visits, which were virtual visits, that if in certain areas our teams are working and we cannot do the supervisory visits, so we use the electronic tools with the different apps for virtual supervisory visits. Then quarterly review of managing financial resources and person days, because working from home is a different experience, totally new. Then we gave a preference to video linkage meetings. A lot has been talked about it. The minimum possible physical interaction and adherence to the Ministry of Health guidelines of using social distancing and using sanitizers and others. Next, please. This shows how we reduce our audit, that if we planned 311 audits, so we thought if the pandemic continues, we can reduce it to 200. Adopting new techniques, our auditors are not used to it. So we thought that since we have to train them, so we have to reduce the audit coverage. Next slide, please. And this is what we expect from INTOSAI to step into in assisting SCEIs to prepare an organic strategy, which can be shared with all the SCEIs. And then combining experiences of all the SCEIs in developing an SCEI standard for disaster response and auditing in pandemic. We have standards for procurement auditing. We need to have standards for pandemic audit in pandemic or in disaster situations. Then bringing in element of standardization in reporting. All the COVID-19 audit reports of different SCEIs, they need to have some standards to follow, because it's a new phenomena, so it needs new ways to think and new strategies to adopt. Thank you very much. I will welcome any questions or any details.
So thank you so much. Dear colleagues, we are very limited in time, and so we have already taken 7 minutes more than we scheduled before. And I would like to ask you for 10, 15 minutes more to conclude this session. We'll ask you to be with us for these minutes for discussion. So we won't be able to take all the questions that were in the chat, but I would like to take just two questions for the discussion today, and all the others will be covered in the written form, as we usually do. The question, which is highly relevant to today's discussion, came from SCEI Spain. We're interested in a quote, we're interested in IT tools for voting procedures. Any experience you can share on this? This is a question to the main speakers of today's webinar, as well as to those who made the comments. Please, if you have any experience on this, and I see Monica, yes, please.
Yes, hello. We have, we still don't have live experience in the preparation of the coming governing board, which will take place within 3 weeks here in Vienna. We have tried one tool which is called Slido, and it allows that you see exactly who has been voting. And also you can say who has not been voting, which is extremely important for example, for governing boards. So you won't get after some weeks the complaint, we never knew that we had to vote. And within our SCEIs, we have the Cisco webinar system also offers a good opportunity to vote. So this is what I wanted to add to this. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Monica. Any other experience from our participants, speakers in particular, on this question? Okay. So you can think it over, or just raise a hand here on the blackboard. And the other question, I think, which is also of high relevance to today's discussion, is what events are most likely to be held in video conference format in future after the pandemic. What are your feelings, predictions on this matter? I mean, at least probably is a question. I don't see the larger context on this, but probably the number of participants or the questions. I see Johanna. Yes, please. The floor is yours.
Sorry, I was trying to turn my microphone and video. I think from the CBC perspective, our experience with these types of webinars where you have a panel, where you have an intention of more one-way communication, even there's scope for some interaction, but you still have like a panel of experts, or you have a clear message that you want sent more than where you want like a proper discussion between everyone who's in the room. I think that's a good type of area to have a webinar setup, a digital setup.
Thank you, Johanna. Monica, please.
Thank you, Timur. I think at the end, I can only echo Johanna. I think to call it like this, like training events, where you present some results or some expertise. There we have made the experience that it's a great to do it virtually, because you have a broad audience without the need for them to displace. But to say like meetings where important decisions have to be taken, I think for those meetings, we should go back to face-to-face meetings, or at least, but on the other hand, I think the virtual meeting will offer also for working group or subcommittees the possibility not only to meet once a year, but also have within shorter time frames meetings virtually to accord or to discuss problems they have faced in the realization, for example, of their strategic development plan, of the work plan. So I think there is a broad scope of possibilities within INTOSAI.
Monica, Johanna, thank you for your highly valuable contribution to this discussion. And I think that we are ready to present you the results of the surveys we've had. And we have started with a question, how do you assess the experience of your SCEI related to the participating in INTOSAI activities during the pandemic? And we see that, so the two answers are leading, live meetings are better, but as it turned out to be possible to hold them online, we should do so in order to save time and resources. And it has proved unprecedentedly useful and shall be explored further. So we see this digital world coming to us in a very high speed, although there are still those who don't see any other solution but to meet, have meetings in face-to-face format. And of course, we all have it inside of ourselves, but have to adapt to the situation that we're facing right now. So thank you for your answers. And now the second question, and I think that we should have it in a more broader context. And I saw Monica's remark that it shouldn't be only the healthcare, but the social security and social care. Of course, we share this broader vision as well. And we'll try to do our best and to include it into the recommendations that we are preparing, and to work on this issue in cooperation with all of you. So thank you for all your answers on these two questions. So I think that's all for today, and thank you for joining. And I would like to thank the speakers and the participants and all those who made the remarks and comments. Even though the series of the SCEI webinars are over. The committee expert group will continue its work. We now have time until the end of October to finalize the drafts of recommendations before submitting them to the INTOSAI governing board. Members of SCEI expert group will receive the draft for review within the week, I think, and we are looking forward to receiving your expert opinion. As for those questions which were left behind today, our speakers will try covering them in a written form. We usually do it at each webinar. Answers will be available in the summary report of the webinar, which all of you will receive shortly. I would like to thank once again all of you. I think we had a very fruitful discussion today. Well, feel free to keep in touch with us via SCEI email address. So you have it on the screen, and I wish you, your colleagues, and your families all the best, good health. Please stay safe and healthy. Thank you very much, and goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.